evening, citizens of Seminaria. I'm your president of the SBC, Gomer Dorca. The S is silent. Broadcasting live from the chapel in a pantsuit, I'm excited to announce another year of the Potluck Games, where every single year, two tributes are picked from every denomination because they are called to ministry, and then they go and fight to the death for martyrdom. Every year before the games, I like to just explain a little bit about why they are in place. Long ago, in 1517, a man named Martin something another decided to nail a piece of paper on a wall. This caused a rift in the very foundations of communities, theology, and the church. They called this the Reformation. In the years following, denominations rose against denominations, fighting, bickering, and creating more spin-offs in the Fast and the Furious franchise. As anyone in power would suggest, war was the only option. Until the preachers from the Prosperity District suggested we capitalize on these disputes and create the Potluck Games, eliminating the weaker denominations while also making a load of cash by viewer revenue. Thus, the games began, and now they happen year after year after year after year. Who wrote this teleprompter? Annually. Anyways, enjoy the 506th annual Potluck Games, and always remember, may the Lord ever look upon you with favor.
Ministry, martyrdom, and murder. Let's start with the male contestant and our spiritual leader of the contestants.
Jebediah Holyfield.
I don't want to be a pastor.
Well, that's too bad. The Lord called you.
Anyways, okay. Moving on to the female contestant, the weaker vessel. Granny Obadiah.
What? Well, that's my name. This is got to be an issue. You're just gonna take me. It takes me just a little bit longer to get up these stairs.
You are old. Like Methuselah.
Now listen, I'm no minister, but I can make a casserole for our benevolence committee.
Well, I know you hauled all this way, but the deacons are now going to take you guys via church van to the training center. May the Lord ever look upon you with favor.
Annual Potluck Games. help?
I thought you weren't doing that.
Welcome to FNL.
Let the games begin.
Looks like a sponsor sent me a casserole.
Have I ever told you about the tragedy of the spring of 23? We hired a lunch lady to work in the dining halls. She seemed like a completely normal individual. But at some point during the spring, she must have suffered some kind of complete mental breakdown because she went amok and killed a bunch of students.
Rest assured, that won't happen with me.
Mom, I don't want to go to Rocky Top.
Why not? It'll be fun.
The only problem you might find in our food, a little food poisoning.
Is there something bad here?
You will have to deal with this spring in the harshest possible way.
Didn't you? I did it. I gave them food poisoning. Here's Gracie! been waiting for, the Baptist Couple Makers. As you all know, BCM is known for plentiful things like discipleship and evangelism. But most importantly, it is known for making great couples. The game is simple. We're going to ask a series of questions to determine the compatibility of some of the Baptist couples here at the BCM. Let me go ahead and introduce to you all our couples for tonight's game. First, we have Evan and Ellie. Here we have Turner and Maggie. And lastly, we have Cannon and Grace. Yes, yes. Okay, the rules are very simple. We have had the ladies answer some questions, and the men are going to see if they can guess the correct answer. Let's start over here with our first question. What is your partner's favorite Bible verse?
I think that one's pretty easy. I'm going to go with John 3:16, because quite frankly, that's the only one she can remember.
I literally have Genesis 1:1 tattooed on my arm.
Okay, didn't ask.
Okay, that's incorrect, but better luck next time. Let's go ahead, next couple.
Well, Maggie doesn't actually have a favorite verse. It's more of a chapter because she's too indecisive. But her favorite chapter would be 1 Kings 18 because it's where Elijah is like yelling at the prophets of Baal and making fun of them. There's something about it that just really reminds me of her.
No, Turner, it's Romans 8:39 because it talks about how height can't separate you from the love of God, and that just really resonates with me.
Is that because you're kind of short?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Well, that's all right. You know, we didn't make it this time for a point, but better luck next time. All right, down to the couple here on the end. What answers do you all have?
Grace's favorite verse is John 20, verse 4.
Yes! Okay, can you tell me what that verse is?
Yeah. So it's where John was outrunning Peter going to the tomb. And, you know, I just love to win. And I love to run. So that part just really resonates with me.
Wow. Okay, that's great. Well, all right, we've got a point on the board for this couple. Great job. All right. Let's move on to question number two. All right, what is your partner's favorite worship song?
I can't remember. Do you remember that annoying VBS song that's always stuck in my head?
Say Yes to VBS.
Oh yeah, that's the one. It's because it's the only one you've ever seen.
I literally lead worship every week. It's Reckless Love.
Okay, well, it's a little odd, but we'll just go ahead and move on to the next couple.
Well, once again, Maggie's too indecisive, so it's really just anything by Elevation Worship because, you know, it's like, it takes far too long to get to the point and goes on for like 10 minutes. There's just something about it that they really have in common.
Wow, Turner, you're so funny tonight.
Oh, I haven't even started yet.
Anyway, my favorite song is More Than Able by Elevation Worship.
Okay.
You do realize that song is actually 10 minutes
long?
Do
you have a problem with me wanting to worship
Maybe
for 10
I do,
minutes?
Because it's far too long for...
Hey, guys, you know, what's good here is that kind of counts as a correct answer. You both wrote Elevation Worship. Yeah, let's count that. I think they need it. They need that. Okay. All right, what about you all at the end? What did you write down?
My Grace's favorite song should be very easy for y'all to guess. It's Amazing Grace, y'all. Because she's Grace, and you know, she's amazing. I reckon that hymn must have been written about her.
That's really sweet, but you do know it was written like 200 years ago or something, right?
Well, it's like a foretelling, you know, like how the people in the Bible talk about Jesus.
Like a prophecy? Okay, well, shucks.
You sure do know me. Let me tell you, okay? My granddaddy's favorite song was Amazing Grace, so my mama was named Grace, and then my mama named me Grace, and I'm just so glad you connected the dots.
Well,
so smart.
Congratulations to this couple on another right answer. All right, folks, that's enough for this segment of the Baptist Couple couple makers. We'll be back later with more questions. All right, folks, we're back with our couples. And right now, Kenan and Grace are in the lead with 2 points on the scoreboard. But it is still anybody's game. So let's move on to our next question. All right, starting over here. What is the ideal biblical wedding location?
Oh, it's too easy. It's definitely where Moses parted the Red Sea. I mean, can you think of all the scenic views? And even better, the free seafood for catering.
Are you serious? My answer is a Garden of Eden. Why in the world would I pick the Red Sea?
Come on, Elle, it's the free seafood!
Okay, well, no points for Evan and Ellie yet, but let's just go ahead and take a look at our next contestants.
Well, it's obviously the riverbank where Jesus fed the 5,000, because what's bad about a riverfront view and free food? And I know Maggie's too cheap to pay for a reception anyway, so this is the only way I get to eat.
Wow. Actually, I picked the Mount of Olives because I love the mountains and the view, and should really watch your mouth calling me cheap because I know your mom pays for everything.
Whatever.
I know she does.
Guys, let's not make the audience uncomfortable, okay? That's all right. There's still another question. Maybe there's hope for you all still. All right, let's move on down for our end of the row contestants here. What answers did we have?
Now, y'all sit down, boys, and I'll show you how it's done. Grace would choose the wedding in Cana of Galilee. You know, where Jesus turned that water into wine?
You know me so well. Let me tell you, I love me some good wine every now and again. Because we're Baptists, we only get grape juice as with our communion. But every now and then, I'm a Methodist, and I enjoy their communion a little bit better.
You do remember this is the Baptist couple makers, right?
Oh, yes. I'm just Methodist every fifth Sunday.
Okay. I guess technically that's another point on the board, but let's keep going. This time, the ladies are going to be guessing the boys' answers. So, Ellie, tell me, what did Evan say is his favorite thing about you?
That's a really thoughtful question. Obviously, it's my musical talent. He just loves the way I serve the Lord with it.
That's close, but it's really because Ellie is a Proverbs 31 woman, meaning she knows her place, if you know what I mean.
I wouldn't do that. Let's keep moving on. Okay, what about you two? What answer do we have here?
Well, I thought a lot about this question, and it's my compassion.
Well, that is an answer. I said it was that you're never going to make more money than me, because I'm going into the medical field and you're not.
Oh, wow! This just gets better and better, so now I'm cheap and I'm not going to make any money?
Well, I wasn't going to say it out loud, but apparently you were ready for this.
Remember, this is a game. It's for fun, so that's not fun. Let's just keep moving on. All right, what do we have down here?
Well, I said that Kanan just loves my cooking skills. Let me tell you, I gotta keep my man fed, and he just loves it.
You bet she's a good cook. She makes the best Rocky Mountain oysters you'll ever have tasted.
Kanan and Grace are really racking up the points. I'm so impressed. Wait, but what are Rocky Mountain oysters?
Well, I don't know if I'm allowed to say this on air, but let's just say there ain't any more male sheep left on the farm.
Okay, then. Well, let's go ahead and take that break before our finale here and our last two questions. All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. We're here with our grand finale of the Baptist Couple Makers. Let's get right to it. All right, let's start over here with Evan and Ellie. What biblical character reminds you most of your man?
I would say Abraham. Probably because he keeps calling me a sister in front of other girls. But I guess it's sweet.
I was thinking Jesus.
What?
I mean, Jesus probably had a cool beard, and I've got a pretty good beard.
We can talk about that later. Let's just go ahead and move on. Next.
Well, there's so many biblical men that remind me of Turner. We got Judas Iscariot because he betrayed Jesus, and that just kind of reminds me of you.
Oh, come on.
I'm not finished. We got King David because he can't keep his eyes off other women.
Okay, now you're lying.
And we've got King Solomon because he has all those wives, just like you had all those women!
Whatever! You don't know! We were on a break!
We were really on a break!
I didn't cheat on you!
I need you guys to sit down. Sit down. Spread away from each other for a little bit. We'll come back later to that. Maybe you can bring us back.
Yes, yes. Well, my Canaan, he's just so much like Jacob. Did you put Jacob on? Now, let me explain, okay? Now, Jacob in the Bible, he waited 14 years before marrying Rachel. And that's just what my little Canaan's been doing. He's been working on my granddaddy's farm, and one day we're going to live there once we get married.
Oh, I bet I would work 1,400 years for you, Grace.
Well, that was a lot. Congratulations on another point, I guess, guys. Let's just wrap this up with one final question. Okay, what animal would your partner want to leave off the ark, Ellie?
Oh, Evan would definitely leave snakes off the ark. He's terrified of them.
Wrong. I'm not scared of anything.
Really?
All right, cool. Evan's scared of snakes. Didn't ask. Don't care. Whatever.
I guess you know his answer.
Okay. That was mildly unexpected, but next contestant. All right, you two. What do you got?
Well, Turner doesn't like anything, so he would leave every single animal off the ark.
You're really going to be like that? You know it's bears. It's always bears. It's been bears ever since we watched Cocaine Bear, and I got so scared that I haven't been able to sleep for 2 weeks.
Really? I didn't watch the movie, but I didn't think it was that scary.
Well, it was scary to me, Sam!
Okay. That's all right. It's okay. Grace?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What about Cannon? What's he leaving off the
Well, arc? Cannon would not take the flying squirrels. Flying squirrels just ain't natural, okay, y'all? Like, how can squirrels fly?
Whoa, that's exactly what I wrote down.
Oh, my gosh!
There just ain't no good reason that a squirrel should fly.
Yep.
In my opinion, God gave them squirrels two jobs.
Mm-hmm.
Burying acorns in the winter and being targets for Meemaw's BB gun.
Yep.
You got it right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I think we have figured out who our Baptist couple is. I think Cannon and Grace, you all are going to be our winners. All right, let me give you all your crown, and we are so excited to tell you that we will be paying for your next date.
Oh my gosh, Cannon, can you believe that? No. Sam's going to pay for our next noodling trip.
Well, now calm down, y'all. Noodling's just fishing.
No. That's what he likes to say.
All right, well, I guess congratulate our Baptist couple if you see us later. Thanks for being with us, our Baptist couple maker.
All right, guys, we've had a lot of laughs so far. We're gonna slow it down, and we're gonna worship. We're gonna sing "Reckless Love" together. Dude, we don't even know Freebird. Do you guys know Freebird? Do you guys know Freebird? I've heard Freebird before. I guess we could figure it out. Sure, if I don't play Freebird.
Chop, Church Lady Smackdown, where four church ladies compete to earn a jewel for their crown in heaven. In round one, we saw Miss Luann leave after her fellowship hall snack was placed on the chopping block. The judges were extremely offended when she only mixed the Country Time lemonade mix with 2 gallons of water.
Miss Luann, peace be with you.
And also with you. After we said peace be with you to Miss Luann, the casserole round proved to be a challenge for Miss Roberta. Her famous man must not live on bread alone casserole started off strong, but went downhill when she started using Bible pages instead of Ritz crackers as a topping.
Miss Roberta, peace be with you.
And also with you. Now, our final and most important round, the dessert table. Our final two competitors are Miss Lorraine and Miss Bertha. Our ingredients tonight are Swiss mix hot cocoa mix, bargain brand cheese crackers, brownies from 2 soul foods ago, and old milk.
Ladies, you have 30 minutes until the church picnic begins.
Bargain brand cheese crackers, I'd immediately thought of my famous chocolate cheese it pie. It was a no-brainer, really. Cool. I decided to make.
Can you speak up a little louder?
I decided to make squirrel surprise.
Doesn't the name kind of ruin the surprise?
Oh, the squirrel ain't the surprising part, sweetie.
Ladies, put your dishes on the dessert table. All right, have you made your decision?
Yes, I have. Squirrel surprise is on the chopping block.
Miss Bertha, you have been chopped. The judges felt like that even though you use the ingredients very intentively, the risk for contracting rabies is just too high for them to sample your dessert. Also, Miss Lorraine did pray to win, so she has God and basic hygiene on her side. Miss Bertha, peace be with you.
And also with you.
Miss Lorraine, you will receive a jewel for your crown in heaven. Congratulations. Your reward means nothing on earth but its eternal value. Join us next time for another episode of Chopped, Church Lady Smackdown.
I swear, they're always late for these meetings. Every single time.
Father Joel!
None of that. All right, folks. We're about 2 years removed from COVID-19. and I need some new Botox. So we need to come up with a plan to get people back into church. I think I want to write the Book of Joel. We can keep it simple. Publishing has always worked well for us as long as we continue to say the same things in a little bit different ways to make it sound a little bit more meaningful.
Actually, I'm pretty sure that's already been taken.
What? By who? Did Billy Joel finally write his autobiography?
No, I believe it was the prophet Joel.
Prophet? What prophet? I haven't seen any prophet in 2 years. Hence why we're having this meeting, Vicky. Book sales are down, tithes are down, and stocks are down. How do you think we're going to be able to fund our missionaries to go to Turks and Caicos?
Joel, it was the prophet from the Bible, you know, the book you preach on every Sunday.
No, I don't know what you're talking about, Vicky. I have not read that thing. I autographed him. We got to give the people what they want.
Well, I think you need to check your heart on that situation.
All right. I think I get it. Don't waste your breath, Vicky. Do we have any other ideas that don't involve me having to do work?
Reverend Osteen, what if we started a proxy campus?
Yeah. Now that, Vicky, is a great idea. Where's a good place to put it, do you think?
What if we bought, hear me out, Neyland Stadium? It even comes with a band. We can call it the Pride of the Promised Land. We just have to decide where to pull the funds from.
What do you think, Vicky?
Well, for starters, I would say we pull back on the Merlot for the communion wine every week. But Neyland has a contract with Aramark, so we will serve Truly's for service.
You know, Vicky, I'm really starting to not like this whole trend where you shoot down all my ideas because it doesn't fit your theology. If we're going to make this work, then my theology has to be your theology, Vicky. We can even change it up and call it Osteology.
I'm pretty sure that one's already taken, too, by science. It's the study of bones.
I didn't ask, Vicky. We got any other ideas, folks?
Rabbi, what if we just went back to our roots and tried to go back into publishing? You have a keen ability to make everyone overly confident in themselves.
I think that's good, Bill. I've actually been thinking over the past few years. I'd like to write my own Bible version. I'm thinking we can call it the JSV, Joel's Standard Version. It's like 33% shorter, and it's only half as convicting as regular Bibles.
Well, it would cost less to print. But doesn't Revelation 22 say something about not adding or taking away scripture from the Bible?
Not in the JSV, it won't.
No. I think that might alienate our audience. Are there any other things we can do in publishing?
Well, you could start, Vicky, by actually appreciating what I have to say. We could also write a book series that really addresses the struggles of our society and how to handle them as believers. I'm thinking we could address hot-button topics such as how to properly ask for the manager when the Starbucks employee makes your drink and it's not hot. Like, have they not read the verse in Revelation chapter 3, probably, where it says that it is better to be hot or cold? I've never understood why they get mad when I spit out my lukewarm coffee at them.
You know what, Bishop Joel? That sounds like such a great idea. I hate when that happens. We can even call it Faith in Frappuccinos, a believer's guide to modern-day Christian persecution and confrontation.
While I like the topic of the series, could we maybe focus on more serious topics, such as violence or war?
Vicky? Vicky, I think you need to better understand who our target demographic is for our books. Topics like these might cause them to feel sad. Or even worse, convicted. Do you know what happens when people become convicted, Vicky? That's right. They stop buying our books. They stop giving to the church, and we make no money. My wife's love suddenly becomes conditional. And worst of all, we have to fly commercial airlines, Vicky. I mean, come on. How am I supposed to shepherd a flock when I can't even leave a carbon footprint for them to follow?
I don't really think that's what they had in mind when they talked about shepherding in the Bible. I don't even think they know what carbon is.
Jesus knew, because he knows everything. And the Bible also tells us, probably, to be more like him, which you seem to struggle with more than most people, Vicky.
Yeah, Vicky, I just don't think your vision for this church is in alignment with our mission statement.
Can I be reminded what this mission statement is?
Oh, by all means, Vicky. Store up for us your treasures on earth so that we can store up for you treasures in heaven.
Amen.
I'm starting to question why I joined this church in the first place. It seems like this church more concerned with growing our budget than the kingdom.
But growing the budget does grow the kingdom, Vicky. Our kingdom. The Osteen Empire. We need more advertisement for our books, our new Joel Osteen hair care line, and our new cosmetic surgery clinic where everyone can look almost as perfect as I do, imitating me as I imitate Christ.
That's it. I think I've been dealing with this ridicule and heresy long enough. I'm starting to think that I'm the only one on this committee who's trying to help the people of this church please God. I'm quitting this church and starting my own at Ayers Hall. And you know what? You know what, Joel? Your face, I hope your budget stays as, I hope your budget stays as frozen as your plastic facial expressions. And you know what else, Joel? Your haircut starting to resemble a kindergartner's take on a mullet, with confusion in the front and blasphemy in the back. And you know what? Your ideas are about as empty as a tomb on Easter morning.
Well, Bill, it looks like our budget issue just solved itself. With Vicky's departure from staff, I think that'll clear up enough room in our budget for my new facelift.
The Lord provides, doesn't he?
Amen, brother.
Any leftover funds can go towards theology classes for staff so that we can train them how to properly convey our message. You can do it because you will, and you will
because you can. Amen, brother. I knew there was a reason I hired you, Bill. Now let's get back to business. Who needs prophets when you've got profit? Am I right, Bill? Don't touch me, Bill. Am I right? Wow.
One, two, one.
Yeah.
4.
Warning, the following program contains graphic depictions of stupidity among four brothers and sisters in Christ competing to embarrass each other.
I'm sorry, I have to leave. I can't do this.
What?
Okay, murder you're thing? You're gonna have to stop right there. That's enough. Thank you so much.
I said how we're doing this. We'll cut at some point.
We're out on campus doing great exchange surveys.
But the twist is, the other jokers are going to be telling us how to share the gospel.
If we don't say what they tell us, we lose.
Exchangers, roll out.
Hey, excuse me, how are you today?
Good, how are you?
Doing well. If you mind taking a brief spiritual interest survey with us?
Yeah, of course.
Awesome. You mind if I sit down?
Yeah, no.
Awesome. What's your name?
Michaela, what's yours?
I'm Ryan.
Nice to meet you, Ryan.
Nice to meet you, too. Could you briefly describe your spiritual background for me?
Yeah, it was like, we grew up in the church, but the pastor turned out to be a drug dealer, and it was like really bad, and then he kept...
Stop her and say that's enough. Mid-track.
Recruiting people into drug dealing, and then there was this whole murder
you're
thing.
You're going to have to stop right there. That's enough. Thank you so much. What do you think happens to you after you die?
We all go to heaven.
I want you to tell her right now. She's going to hell. Inconspicuous.
Go in hell.
What?
Nothing. Don't worry about it. Can I pray for you?
Yeah.
Pray for her, but sing while doing it.
Awesome. Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for this conversation with Kayla.
I was going to ask you if it would be okay if you wanted to take a spiritual interest survey.
Yeah, I think that'd be fine.
Awesome,
yeah.
Can I sit?
Yeah, for sure.
Great. So, the first question is, what do you believe is mankind's greatest problem?
I just don't really think people are just really accepting enough of other people's lifestyles. You know, I just think we need to be more open to that. I think by not being open to that, just...
Sing Anti-Hero by Taylor Swift.
But sing it sweetly.
It's me! Hi, I'm
Tommy. Get out of here.
Woo. That was a lot.
Are you okay?
I'm great. Okay. Thanks. So, next question. On a scale of 1 to 10, how good are you? 1 being evil and 10 being perfect.
You know, I've done some pretty bad things in my life. I would say I'd probably be a 1 on that scale. Yeah.
Hey, flirt with him and tell him he's an absolute 10.
I'm sorry, I have to leave. I can't do this.
What?
Maggie couldn't share the gospel effectively, so she's first up on the loser board.
Slides,
and we have to do whatever they say, no matter what. But why am I in short shorts?
Good luck. You'll find out soon enough.
Thank you all for coming. My name is Jackson. I'm giving a presentation on modesty, where you draw the line, ECM dress code. First, if we're unsure about whether we want to wear it, we have to ask ourselves, would we want to see Rodney in this? Just think about that. Remember, biblically, modest is hottest. Our honest answers to these questions may lead us, and hopefully will, It is for important life changes.
You have to say the phrase. Say it. Say duh!
For us. And remember, if it's above the knees, if it's above the knees, you can't wear
it. Make them say it too.
Say it with me. If it's above the knees. No, not the, duh. If it's above the knees, you can't wear tees. Good. Lacoste. Shirts with cap sleeves can't be worn alone.
Hey, there's a shirt in the podium. Put it on for me.
Undershirts shouldn't be noticeable. Long sleeves only. No crop tops. No collarbones or shoulders should be shown. No crop tops. Like this.
Take it off and put it in the garbage.
Proverbs 31:12 says, she does him good and not evil all the days of her life. So ladies, do him good.
Now, strut your stuff.
To the bottoms. You must wear skirts and shorts that are below the knees. Women are not allowed to wear pants or shorts outside of recreational activities.
Hey, say the phrase one more time.
And remember, it's above the knees, you can't wear these. Say it with me again, ladies. If it's above the knees, you can't wear these. That's great.
All right, play the video.
We have a video to watch. Let's watch it.
Have you ever met a girl that you think is hot, but she looks like a human tackle box? She's fierce here and there, tattoos everywhere. She would be my mother, white and scared. Looking like an addict walking down the street. You know her good to be selling cheap. With a skirt up to here, collar to there, she knows what works when the sock and stick.
What with all the makeup looks like a disguise, I wanna see her face, not her regular eyes. Got attitude so thick, you can cut with a knife. Do you really want a girl like this for wife?
Modest girls are the hottest girls, more precious than diamonds and rings of pearls. Classy, confident, image of a goddess. Remember my words, your hottest is the hottest.
Remember, hottest is hottest. And you all look upset that this presentation was made by a woman.
Say no touchy touchy.
No touchy touchy. Okay? And you have to say everything with extreme joy. You aren't allowed to say, I don't know. That is the worst phrase here at BCM. You have to make sure that you make something up on the spot. You cannot ask any staff either. And I don't know is off limits.
Ask for a question, but reply, I don't know.
Do not talk about school, work, or other ministries because they don't exist in this building. And no talk about psychology either.
Hey, guy in the front that's not paying attention, grab his phone and chuck it across the room. Duck behind the podium and make the Mario noise.
Do, do, do.
And then crawl out like they can't see you and pop up in the door.
Like,
Tell that short one in the front, tell her to get out. Tell her to get out, bring her chair, get her out of there.
Not the chair.
Out of here, out of here.
You, go, take the chair. Go. You have no hope of becoming a BCM breeder.
Jackson and Elizabeth were able to convince rowdy crowds of their new ideas. So that means Maggie is tonight's biggest loser.
Maggie is tonight's biggest loser, so she has to do a punishment.
Tonight she'll be with her life group. My punishment is just life group?
If that's what you want to think, sure. Just make sure your ringer's on max.
And did you get those half off?
What Maggie doesn't know is that we changed her ringtone
to one of the finest Christian songs of 2007.
Hey everyone, thanks for coming to Life Group tonight. So we're going to be talking about Matthew 6 and the Sermon on the Mount. So everybody, turn to your Bibles for Matthew 6.
I'm so sorry. Let me turn this off.
Actually, you're gonna leave it on.
Abby, do you wanna start reading in Matthew 6, verse 1?
Yeah, sure.
Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of people to be seen by them. Otherwise, you will have no fellas. Yeah, fellas, yeah, the girlfriend's got the book. Read it, read it, read it, read it. Read that holy book. Baby, I'm in, I'm in the ribbon bookmark. Becky, I know you turned that off.
Say you're gonna turn it off, but you thought you might get a call more important than life group.
I thought that I'm gonna get a call more important than life group.
Maggie, are we not important?
You guys, let's get back to reading. Scott, do you wanna read verse 2? We see in this passage, it's Jesus talking about a lot of things that apply to us today that are really important for us to think about.
Yeah, baby. When it comes to a good book, Stephen King's resume just can't compare.
All right, this time, struggle to get it out on purpose.
9 plus 27 equals 66 books. And if you're Catholic, there's even more.
Get out! Not that way, out that door.
I'm so sorry.
Get out of here! Over here.
Thanks.
Hello, welcome to Healing Faith Holistic Medicine. How may I help you?
Well, I need to get seen like immediately. I think I'm going blind. So, is there any way you can do a walk-in appointment?
Of course. We don't actually take appointments. We already had you on our calendar. As you were predestined to come in at this time. You are Jonathan Johnson, correct?
Yes. How did you know my name?
Yeah, your name is written in our Book of Life, so I knew before you walked in.
All right. Great. I'll just sit over in the waiting area.
Hey, Jonathan. My name's Dr. Benedict, and I'll be doing your exam today. I just need to get this one test on you real quick, so if you just want to place your forehead right up against this machine.
Okay.
Just gonna look straight ahead, eyes real wide.
Ah! What was that?
That was just the Holy Spirit. It's okay if it freaks you out a little bit. The Bible does say that we are supposed to fear God, so that was an appropriate response.
What the heck?
I'm afraid I have some unfortunate news. It looks like you have a condition known as retinitis pigmentosa.
What the heck? What is that? Is there any suggested treatment for it?
I'm afraid the best treatment option here would for you to learn how to walk by faith and not by sight.
What are you saying?
You are progressively going blind.
Oh my gosh, that's horrible. Are you sure there's nothing else we can do?
Well, there is this one treatment, and it's only been tried once before. It's a little bit experimental. It actually involves me spitting in some mud and some rubbing it into your eyes.
Well, I guess it can't really get any worse from here, so I'm willing to try anything.
Okay.
There you go. Now, Doc, are you sure this thing is safe? I mean, I've heard of mud masks and stuff, but this seems more like a biblical spa treatment.
Oh, don't worry. This mud isn't just any mud. It's premium, divine grade, straight from the Garden of Eden mud, guaranteed to improve your spiritual and ocular clarity.
Oh, I see. Well, I don't actually see, but maybe I will after this.
Okay, well, you can go wash that off in the sink, and then we'll see if your vision's improved at all.
Sweet.
Okay, let's see if you can read this line here. Just tell me what the letters are here.
H-E-G-A-V-E-H-I-S-O-N-L-Y.
That's perfect. It looks like your sight is fully recovered. You're seeing perfectly.
That's amazing. Thanks, Doc.
Don't thank me. I'm just out here trying to do the Lord's work.
Oh.
Another success story for Healing Faith Holistic Medicine. Now let's go see our next patient.
Hi, I'm Nurse Ratchet. How can I help you today?
I've just been constantly dehydrated. No matter how much I drink gallons of water every day, but I'm just constantly thirsty.
Is there any way I can see what type of water you've been drinking?
I've just been drinking like normal water. I get it from like the tap and then I like run it through my Brita, but you know, I just drink this normal water, but I just am constantly thirsty.
Yeah, I think I can see what the problem is. You need to be drinking living water. That kind of water is gonna make you thirsty again.
Where do I get this living water?
Well, you can't buy it actually.
Why can't I buy it?
Well, it's already been bought for you.
Well, they never gave it to me.
Let's see how the physical therapy department is doing.
So, have you ever heard the story of Jesus healing the lame man?
Yeah, but I thought I was just here for physical therapy today.
Yeah, but here we just do things a little bit differently. So we're gonna get your legs strong and ready to go so you can walk up the stairway to heaven.
Well, I just got my double leg replacement surgery done yesterday. None of the doctors said this was a good idea to walk today. Are you sure this is okay?
Yeah, it'll be fine. Just pick up your wheelchair and follow me.
Oh, my legs!
Oh, you of little faith. The reason you fell is because you didn't trust in me.
This is the worst pain I've ever felt in my life.
It's just the sin leaving your body. It's working now.
My attorneys are gonna hear about this.
Well, here at the clinic, we only submit to one judge, so you can leave all of your complaints in our offering plate along with your monthly tithe.
As you can see, we strive for the best patient care, with faith guiding our every step. We hope to see you back for any of your spiritual or health needs. Oh no, 600 commuters can't find parking anywhere on campus? What am I gonna do?
Poof.
Who are you?
Bob, I'm your shoulder angel. Can you give me a second?
That's...
Bob, the parking situation just keeps getting worse. Shouldn't your integrity be enough to solve this? I mean, you can just give up your own spot and then give it to a commuter. You just have to park farther away.
Dang it. All of my construction projects on campus are delayed for 6 months. We ordered the wrong shade of orange paint, and Bob wants to build a new parking lot and residence hall. What am I gonna do?
Poof!
Who are you?
Hey, man, I'm your shelter devil.
I just dapped up the devil. What are we doing here?
Yeah. What's just go with it.
What's going on? Okay.
Yeah. All right.
too old for this, devil.
It's much easier with the toddlers. All right, now Cornelius, you don't have to delay those projects. Who cares if you use the wrong color orange paint? It's gonna get covered up by black mold in a couple years anyway. I mean, the BCM has used the wrong orange for years.
All right, I'll do it.
What?
All right, I'll do it.
What? You again? Really?
Excuse me, Bob. Someone needs my help.
Cornelius, somebody needs my bad influence.
Okay.
Cornelius, you can't use that paint.
Why not? No one's gonna notice.
Look, the buildings are already concrete. It won't matter. And it's not like it's gonna make the Haslam kids any smarter.
Now, Bob, you don't have to give up your parking spot. You've worked hard for that parking spot. Just let the students walk like they always do. Tell them there's parking available at Sorority Village, like you've always done. And if you need to give up a parking spot, just take it from construction.
What?
Oh, I forgot he could hear me.
Okay.
I'll do it.
Wait, what?
What?
Hold on, Cornelius, I'm coming back. Go up some more, Cornelius. We gotta work together. Okay, whatever. Could you get me?
Sure.
Alright. Alright, you wet blanket goody two shoes. How about I keep the half-breed ginger and you can keep the neck beard?
Hey!
Oh, I forgot you were here.
Alright, our next project will be to build a new dorm and a new parking garage.
We're gonna have to delay construction and we're gonna close down parking on Caledonia and one of the exits to the terrace garage.
Wait, what?
Ha ha!
Rocky Top, Tennessee!
Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to Weekend Update, your best source for news, sports, weather, other news things. My name is Evan.
And I'm Whitney.
In the latest plot twist in the celebrity dating game, Taylor Swift and Travis Kelce are reportedly an item. It seems that Taylor is going for a different kind of catch these days. I guess when you've conquered the music charts, the next logical step is the relationship scoreboard. Let's just hope their relationship doesn't have a tight end. Or maybe that's exactly what they're going for.
The entertainment industry has been taken over by streaming services such as Netflix, Hulu, Tubi, HBO Max, Amazon Prime. You get the picture. It's like a battle royale of TV shows. You know, I think my remote is going to go to the Olympics for a gold medal in channel surfing.
It looks like once again the presidential race is canceled, and we will see yet another geriatric mosey between Donald Trump and Joe Biden for the hot seat in what seems to be more like the White Hare House in today's politics. It's almost like a competition between two rock stars who refuse to retire. I think we can expect a campaign slogan to be, "Make America remember where it put its car keys again." It may be less of a policy debate and more of an old-fashioned game of Thursday night bingo. And I guess their caretakers are going to have to be their running mates.
The dynamic duo of 2023 movies, Barbie and Oppenheimer, or more commonly referred to as Barbenheimer, has taken explosive effects over the globe. If they wanted to nail the plastic doll effect, they should have gotten someone who is actually made of plastic, like America's favorite stand-up comedian, Matt Rife.
The year 2023 was big for weather. We saw catastrophic flooding across 12 countries in 10 days, the hottest ocean temperatures ever recorded, heat waves that scorched the entire northern hemisphere, a drought in the Horn of Africa that takes the spot as the worst drought in the last 40 years, and a snowstorm that made all of Knoxville have no idea how to live as functioning members of society.
The Super Bowl this year was one for the ages, a historic game where the Chiefs It's better if I read my teleprompter, am I right, everybody? All right. We saw the Chiefs win their second Super Bowl in a row and a greater than $1 billion economic impact, record high ticket revenue, and it looks like Usher won the job for the newest Avenger.
In other sports news, a record snowstorm pummeled Buffalo, New York, just before the Bills matchup with the Pittsburgh Steelers. Stadium staff was bewildered when they could not find their tarp to cover the field in preparation for the snow and had to postpone the game. Staff and fans were even more confused when they saw Lizzo wearing the exact same tarp to the MTV Awards ceremony.
KFC has created a new menu item that's a combination of fried chicken and pizza, and they're calling it Chitza. But it also comes with a warning label of a combination of adverse reactions called vomaria.
Joe Biden just recently won the Democratic primary in the state of South Carolina by just barely beating his closest competitor, Time.
In some devastating news, Omegle, a platform where children can talk to strangers online without supervision, has been shut down. Where else are we going to find friends these days?
It's a good question. I'm at a loss myself.
Elon Musk's brain chip project, Neuralink, is the ultimate I've got enough for that moment. It's like Elon is trying to recreate the real-life version of The Matrix. But instead of dodging bullets, we'll be dodging pop-up ads and requests to accept all cookies. And let's not forget about the potential for glitches. I can already hear people saying, "Hold on, my brain is buffering." But hey, at least we will have an excuse to forget birthdays. Except MacArthur.
Well, everybody, he's back.
Oh, indeed he is. The year 2023 marks the return of Florida Man in all of his craziness. Let's take a look at some of the most notable things that Florida Man was up to this past year.
Florida Man sets fire to a rabbi's van in Fort Lauderdale.
Florida Man pulls out a pistol after his Wingstop order was late.
Florida Man loses his arm to an alligator after using the bathroom in the alligator's pond.
You know, I can't really blame the alligator for that one.
Me either.
Florida Man faces federal charges after riding a human-sized hamster wheel in the Atlantic Ocean.
Florida Man throws his Subway sandwich at a worker and then kills his roommate. Stay away from processed meats, everybody.
Florida Man gets arrested after refusing to pay for his Waffle House tattoo.
Florida Man is finally arrested after robbing the same Dollar Tree 12 times over the course of the year.
And finally, Florida Man intentionally hits a deer with an SUV for a social media video.
Man, Florida Man really showed out this year. The only thing that's left to do is reveal the real Florida Man.
In music news, Beyonce has recently decided to take talents into other genres like country music with two new releases titled 16 Carriages and Texas Hold'em. While many listeners do not appreciate this recent endeavor, others seem to be rather fond of it. Here with us this evening is our local Beyonce country apologist.
Welcome, welcome.
Thank you for having me.
So, just tell us, how do you feel about Beyonce's new country project?
I mean, to be honest, I've been excited about this since rumor circulated a couple years ago that she would do a country project, but I really wasn't expecting the amount of criticism that would come about saying that she can't do country music.
Is this why you've come on the show tonight?
It is. I think to establish that Beyonce can in fact do country music, we first have to establish what country is. So what do you guys think is a characteristic of country?
Well, I think where a person is from is often important. Like, country singers are generally from the South.
Well, that's great. Beyonce's from Houston, Texas.
Okay, but is Texas really a part of the South?
Well, the SEC's about to think so, and they get a lot of my tuition. And even if it wasn't country, I mean, Shania Twain's from Canada. That's definitely not the South. And Keith Urban's from Australia. That's so far South, it's a completely different accent.
But what about the way she dresses? Shouldn't she dress more country?
I mean, how often do you really see Carrie Underwood wearing a cowboy hat? And Beyonce has went out and she's worn a cowboy hat and boots every time she's made a public appearance since she dropped the singles. And I've done the same thing. Cost me a pretty penny too. And I haven't taken them off.
Did you already own those?
Oh, of course not. I bought them right after she released the singles.
Okay, fine. But don't you think the way she performs and dances is not necessarily fit for country music?
Are you serious right now?
Yes, I am.
Beyonce can sing crazy high notes, is performing full choreography, and is ridiculously consistent. So what if her performances don't look like normal country singers? What does that matter? Who would you rather look at when they perform? Beyonce, Giselle Bundchen, or Jelly Roll? I only came on this show because I was supposed to tell everybody that Cowboy Carter drops March 29th everywhere, and you've insulted Queen Bee. And good luck trying to get a job after this, because the Beehive will cancel you so fast, you won't even have time to say Dolly Parton.
Well, that had more passion behind it than a Call of Duty chat room.
Indeed it did. Thank you for joining us for Weekend Update. Go listen to Beyonce. Yeah.
Hey guys, for those of y'all that don't know me, I really can't see up here. Wow, for those of y'all that don't know me, my name's Drew. I'm one of the small group leaders here. And thank y'all just for coming out tonight. For those of y'all that have never been here before, I just wanna tell you a little bit about what we're all about. Cause I mean, we like to have fun. I hope you see that Christians just aren't sticking the muds, at least most Christians aren't. But the main goal that we're here is just to glorify God with all that we do. We like to joke around and make jokes about Christians and about the Bible, but ultimately, like, that's what we're all about here. We're all about worshiping God. I just want to share with y'all a little bit, like, if you've never heard it before or if you just haven't accepted it, like, we're here because Jesus died for us. We're not perfect. Nobody's perfect. And God requires perfection. And we're never going to measure up to that standard. We're not meant to measure up to that standard. I mean, we are meant to. That's what God requires. But he knows we're not going to make it. And so he sent Jesus for us, who lived this perfect life. He died on the cross. He rose again. And if we believe in him and turn our lives around and focus on God and just make him Lord over our lives and just repent is the word we like to use. Just turn around and turn to God. And we can have that restored relationship and have salvation, have this eternity with Christ. And that's why we're here doing all of this, because we want you all to know that Jesus loves you. No matter how far gone you think you are or what you've done, like, God loves you. He loves you enough that he sent his only son. And that's really, really crazy. It's crazy to me, and like, I've grown up my whole life doing it, like, why would someone so perfect send someone down, send his only son down for someone that's so bad? Because no matter what you've done, you're not too far gone for God. And so that's why we're here doing this, is to share that with everyone. And if y'all want, we can pray and then close it out for the night. God, we're just so thankful for all that you've given us. Thank you for your son. God, I pray that if there are people here that don't know him, I pray that they would seek him out tonight. God, I pray that they would just either ask me or Rodney, Sam, somebody that they've seen up here, and that they would leave knowing that they know you and who you are. Thank you just for this time that we can come together and laugh. In your name I pray. Amen. I think this is the last thing we have.
Bloopers.
Bloopers? Okay, sweet.
When? Oh.
Oh.
I'm crying. Okay. I'm trying. Okay.
Ladies, you have 30 minutes. I forgot the rest.
I decided to make.
Can you speak up some? That
Welcome to Chop, Church Lady Smackdown.
Oh, no.